Thank you. Good evening. Welcome to God's house on this wonderful and beautiful day that the Lord has given us. And it only gets better as we come into his presence now and receive his good and gracious gifts as we focus on the epistle reading for the week and the blessings that we have because we are justified by the blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. On the way out tonight, both the new portals of prayer as well as the Lutheran Women's Quarterly are available, so feel free to grab those on the front table on the way out. For those of you that are worshiping with us at home, if you would like a copy of either or both dropped off at your house or mailed to you, just let Jackie know in the church office and we'll make sure that we get that to you. In our prayers today, we'll be lifting up in prayer Dawn Dywert, who had back surgery earlier today. She didn't make it out of surgery and is recovering up at the hospital in Indianapolis. Also, Barbara Hughes remains hospitalized up in Indianapolis. In addition, there's been one person added to the prayer list, Tim Wilkerson, a friend of Carolyn Wilkerson, a family friend of Carolyn Wilkerson, who is hospitalized. So if you could add Tim Wilkerson to your prayers. And we'll also be lifting up in prayer tonight two families that are grieving, the family of Ken White, that is Teresa Sperling's father, who died on Saturday. His funeral was earlier today. And then also the family of Jerry Brown, who is the treasurer for Orphan Grain Train, has served in that capacity for a number of years. He died unexpectedly. So we lift up his family in prayer as well. We'll be following the service as it's outlined on the bulletin insert. I invite you to open your hymnals to our opening hymn, hymn 430, My Song is Love Unknown.
Thank you.
I invite you to turn to page 288 and to stand as we pray the litany. O Lord, O Christ, O Lord, O Christ, God the Father in heaven, God the Son, Redeemer of the world, God the Holy Spirit, be gracious to us. Be gracious to us. From all sin, from all error, from all evil, from the crafts and assaults of the devil, from sudden and evil death, from pestilence and famine, from war and bloodshed, from sedition and from rebellion, from lightning and tempest, from all calamity by fire and water, and from everlasting death, by the mystery of your holy incarnation, by your holy nativity, by your baptism, fasting, and temptation, by your agony and bloody sweat, by your cross and passion, by your precious death and burial, by your glorious resurrection and ascension, and by the coming of the Holy Spirit the Comforter, in all time of our tribulation, in all time of our prosperity, in the hour of death and in the day of judgment, we poor sinners implore you to rule and govern your holy Christian church, to preserve all pastors and ministers of your church in the true knowledge and understanding of your wholesome word, and to sustain them in holy living, to put an end to all schisms and causes of offense, to bring into the way of truth all who have erred and are deceived, to beat down Satan under our feet, to send faithful laborers into your harvest, and to accompany your word with your grace and spirit, to raise those who fall and to strengthen those who stand, and to comfort and help the weak-hearted and the distressed, to give to all peoples concord and peace, to preserve our land from discord and strife, to give our country your protection in every time of need, to bless, to direct and defend our president and all in authority, to bless and protect our magistrates and all our people, to watch over and help all who are in danger, necessity, and tribulation, to protect and guide all who travel, to grant all women with child and all mothers with infant children increasing happiness in their blessings, to defend all orphans and widows and provide for them, to strengthen and keep all sick persons and young children, to free those in bondage and to have mercy on us all, to forgive our enemies, persecutors, and slanderers, and to turn their hearts, to give and preserve for our use the kindly fruits of the earth, and graciously to hear our prayers. Lord Jesus Christ, Son of God, Christ, the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world, Christ, the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world, Christ, the Lamb of God, who takes away the sin of the world. O Christ, O Lord, O Christ, O Lord. I invite you to turn to the back side of the insert as we continue now with the salutation and collect of the day. The Lord be with you. Let us pray. O God, you see that of ourselves we have no strength. By your mighty power, defend us from all adversities that may happen to the body, and from all evil thoughts that may assault and hurt the soul. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Please be seated. The Old Testament reading is from the 17th chapter of Genesis. When Abram was 99 years old, the Lord appeared to Abram and said to him, I am God Almighty. Walk before me and be blameless, that I may make my covenant between me and you, and may multiply you greatly. Then Abram fell on his face, and God said to him, Behold, my covenant is with you, and you shall be the father of a multitude of nations. No longer shall your name be called Abram, but your name shall be Abraham, for I have made you the father of a multitude of nations. I will make you exceedingly fruitful, and I will make you into nations, and kings shall come from you. And I will establish my covenant between me and you and your offspring after you, throughout their generations, for an everlasting covenant, to be God to you and to your offspring after you. And God said to Abraham, as for Sarai, your wife, you shall not call her name Sarai, but Sarah shall be her name. I will bless her, and moreover, I will give you a son by her. I will bless her, and she shall become nations. Kings of people shall come from her. This is the word of the Lord. The epistle reading from the fifth chapter of Romans, where Paul writes, therefore, since we have been justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. Through him we have also obtained access by faith into this grace in which we stand, and we rejoice in hope of the glory of God. Not only that, but we rejoice in our sufferings, knowing that suffering produces endurance, and endurance produces character, and character produces hope. And hope does not put us to shame, because God's love has been poured into our hearts through the Holy Spirit who has been given to us. For while we were still weak, at the right time Christ died for the ungodly. For one will scarcely die for a righteous person, though perhaps for a good person one would dare even to die. But God shows his love for us, in that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. Since, therefore, we have now been justified by his blood, much more shall we be saved by him from the wrath of God. For if while we were enemies, we were reconciled to God by the death of his Son, much more, now that we are reconciled, shall we be saved by his life. More than that, we also rejoice in God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom we have now received reconciliation. This is the word of the Lord. Please stand as we sing together the Lenten verse. The Holy Gospel according to St. Mark, the 8th chapter. Glory to you, O Lord. And Jesus went on with his disciples to the villages of Caesarea Philippi. And on the way he asked his disciples, who do people say that I am? And they told him, John the Baptist, and others say Elijah, and others one of the prophets. And he asked them, but who do you say that I am? Peter answered him, you are the Christ. And he strictly charged them to tell no one about him. And he began to teach them that the Son of Man must suffer many things, and be rejected by the elders and the chief priests and the scribes, and be killed, and after 3 days rise again. And he said this plainly. And Peter took him aside and began to rebuke him. But turning and seeing his disciples, he rebuked Peter and said, get behind me, Satan, for you are not setting your mind on the things of God, but on the things of man. And calling the crowd to him with his disciples, he said to them, if anyone would come after me, let him deny himself and take up his cross and follow me. For whoever would save his life will lose it. But whoever loses his life for my sake and the gospel's will save it. For what does it profit a man to gain the whole world and forfeit his soul? For what can a man give in return for his soul? For whoever is ashamed of me and of my words in this adulterous and sinful generation, of him will the Son of Man also be ashamed when he comes in the glory of his Father with the holy angels. This is the gospel of the Lord. I invite you to turn to page 206 as we confess our faith in the words of the Nicene Creed. I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and of all things visible and invisible, and in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, begotten of his Father before all worlds, God of God, light of light, very God of very God, begotten, not made, being of one substance with the Father, by whom all things were made, who for us men and for our salvation came down from heaven and was incarnate by the Holy Spirit of the Virgin Mary and was made man and was crucified also for us under Pontius Pilate. He suffered and was buried. And the third day he rose again according to the Scriptures and ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of the Father. And he will come again with glory to judge both the living and the dead, whose kingdom will have no end. And I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord and giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son together is worshipped and glorified, who spoke by the prophets. And I believe in one holy Christian and apostolic church. I acknowledge one baptism for the remission of sins, and I look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. Congregation may be seated. It's time now, boys and girls, for the little sermon. And you're going to have to use your imagination a lot tonight. Whenever you happen to be watching this at home, and for those of you who are here, because I was hoping that this would be a gavel, but I can't find my gavel. So this is what we're going to have to use as a gavel. Now, you may not know what a gavel is, but boys and girls, you know who a judge is, right? Think about a judge in a courtroom. And of course, what does a judge do? Has this thing that looks like a hammer or a mallet, a little mallet in his hand, and says, order in the court. Okay, that's what we're pretending this is, okay? All right. And we're pretending that we're in a courtroom. Now, of course, if you are in a courtroom and you're on trial, if you're standing before a judge, that probably means that someone is accusing you of doing something wrong. Now, boys and girls, we were standing before God, because God is our judge. Have we done some things that are wrong? We have, haven't we? We call those things that we've done wrong sins. Those thoughts that we had that are ungodly, those words that we have spoken that are unkind, those actions that have not been actions that have served other people. And so, boys and girls, if you think about standing before God and standing in his courtroom, God the judge decides if you're guilty or not guilty, what should really be this decision? When he says, order in the court, should God say you're guilty? Or should he say you're not guilty of all those sins? Really, the verdict, the decision should be you're guilty. Because you and me, every person is guilty of sin. We sin every day. But something amazing happens, boys and girls, in God's courtroom. When it's time for God to give the verdict, he doesn't say guilty. Says not guilty. You know why God says not guilty? The answer is Jesus. Because yes, we have sinned, and yes, we deserve punishment for all our sins. God has every right to be angry and to punish us for all our sins. What did Jesus do? Many, many years ago, Jesus took on all our sin, and he took on all the punishment for that sin and all God's wrath for our sin. And where did he take all that dirty sin? cross, didn't he? Gave his life. Because that's the punishment that needed to be paid. That's what he had to suffer to pay the price for our sins. Of course, he didn't stay dead, did he? He came back to life on Easter. And so something amazing happens now. Because Jesus, not guilty, never sinned once. But he took on all our sin. He became the guilty one for you and for me. So now, because Jesus took on all our sin, because he took on all the punishment that we deserve for our sin, now in God's courtroom, the verdict, the decision, is not guilty. You and I are not guilty because all our sins are forgiven because of Jesus. We're wearing that white robe that Jesus gives us that covers all our sin. Boys and girls, the word for that, it's a big word. It's called justification. All right, maybe we can have everybody here say that word. Okay, let's say it together. Justification. All right. And that word, to justify, means to declare not guilty. And that's what our scripture for today is talking about. The blessings that we have. Blessings that we have not because of anything we have done. But the blessings we have because of Jesus. Because he took on our sins. And because of that, when we stand before God the judge, what's he going to say to you, boys and girls? He's not going to say guilty. He's going to say you are not guilty. All because of Jesus. Well, boys and girls, it's time for prayer now. I'll say a line and invite everyone to repeat it after me. So let's fold our hands, close our eyes, and bow our heads, and let's pray. Dear Jesus, we thank and praise you that even though we are guilty, you took on all our sins and died in our place. So we are now justified, not guilty. Thank you, Jesus. And thank you for all the blessings that we enjoy because we are justified. We love you, Jesus. Amen. Boys and girls, thanks so much for worshiping at home. We continue now with the hymn of the day. Thank you. Grace, mercy, and peace to you from God our Father and from our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. Return to the Lord your God, for he is gracious and merciful, slow to anger and abounding in steadfast love. Tonight, as we think about that word, justify, we unpack that word, and then the blessings and the benefits that we have because we are justified by faith, because we are justified by the blood of Christ. Yes, we find that our God is gracious and merciful, that he is slow to anger, abounding in steadfast love because of Jesus, because of what Jesus has done for us, so that now we are justified, so that we are now declared not guilty. When you think about it, it's a scary thought. The Almighty God, as our judge, standing in his courtroom, you're the one on trial, and here come all those ungodly words, all those ungodly actions throughout your entire life, thousands upon thousands. And all the things you failed to do, you should have done. Then come all those secrets, all those secret sins, those sins of thought, those things that you hope no one else would know. And here they are, for there are no secrets that are hid in God's courtroom. And the evidence is presented. And now it's time for God, the righteous judge, to render his verdict. Stand sheepishly before your Creator. You know you're guilty. Yet that verdict comes. Not guilty. Wonder why? The answer is Jesus. Because Jesus, the not guilty one, he has taken on all your guilt, all your sin, all God's righteous wrath, all the punishment that you've deserved for that sin. He, the not guilty one, has become the guilty one for you. Takes all of that to the cross for you. While you were still a sinner, our text says. Back centuries before you were even born, Christ died for you. And because those many centuries ago, Jesus took on all your guilt, all your sin, what do you get? Get his not guiltiness. You are justified. You are clothed in the righteousness of Christ, the perfection of Christ. When God the Father looks at you, he doesn't see you and your sin. He sees his Son and his perfect righteousness. And then the verdict is rendered. Justified. Not guilty. Our text makes it absolutely clear that this is all because of Christ's work. Scripture uses four words to describe our state apart from Christ's work in our lives: weak, ungodly, sinners, and enemies of God. We're weak, spiritually weak, unable to save ourselves. And we're ungodly. It means apart from God, without God, separated from God because of our sin. And certainly ungodly because of our many sins. Yes, we're sinners. Every day we sin. Every day we fall short of the glory of God. And yes, apart from God, enemies of God, not turn to God, but turned away from him. Hence, the cry of the prophet Joel of our theme verse for Lent, return to the Lord your God. Because by nature, we're not turned to God, we're turned away from him. We don't really like the thought or the idea by our sinful nature of the fact that God is our creator and we are his creatures. God's our creator. That means we're accountable to him. That means we don't make the rules. He makes the rules. That means we don't get to decide what's right and wrong. He does. Our sinful nature doesn't like that. So there is this hostility, this enmity between us and God. Apart from the work of Jesus Christ. Weak, we're ungodly. We're sinners, we're enemies of God. And that's how we would be and thus forever separated from God had not the Lord Jesus intervened for us. Not because of our efforts, it's not because of our works, it's not because of anything we can do. I know there are plenty of people that when thinking about their eternal destiny, will say, oh, I think I'll make it to heaven. I've lived a pretty good life. I've tried. Tried my best. But think about standing in God's courtroom. All your sins being brought to light. And at that moment you say, well, I've tried my best. I've tried to live a pretty good life. No, that wouldn't even work in an earthly court, would it? That's not good defense at all. And so we don't plead what we have done. We don't plead our good works. We don't plead the fact that, well, we've tried. Instead, we plead the blood of Christ. Don't look to our works. We look to the work that he has already done and accomplished in our stead. We acknowledge our guilt and then look to the not guilty one. For it is because of him that we are justified, that we are declared not guilty. And so our text for tonight starts with, therefore, since we have been justified by faith, then it just goes one gift, one blessing after another. Because we have been declared not guilty. Because even though we are the chief of sinners, that sin has been atoned for. So we read in our text of these gifts and blessings that we have. Since we have now been justified by his blood, much more shall we be saved from by him from the wrath of God. Because we are justified. We're saved from the wrath of God. Not because God is wrathful. God is just. Where there is sin, the just judge, a price must be paid for that sin. There is going to be wrath over sin. And yet, Jesus has already endured that wrath for us. So we are spared from that wrath that we rightfully deserve. And therefore, since we don't have to endure the wrath of God over our sin, our scripture goes on to say, because we are justified, we are reconciled with God. Again, the text, for if while we were enemies, we were reconciled to God by the death of his son, much more now that we are reconciled, shall we be saved by his life. Reconciled. No longer enemies, no longer separated from God, but put back into a right relationship with Him. All because of Jesus. God is our judge. That's not how we relate to God, is it? Why? Because we've been reconciled through Christ. Because of His reconciling work, we don't come before God sheepishly, as if we are standing before a judge. We approach God as our Heavenly Father. Because Jesus, because of the work He has done, we are children of the Heavenly Father, adopted now into the family of God. So we approach the God of the universe as our Father, with all boldness and confidence, knowing that He does love us, knowing that He wants what is best for us, that as our Father, He is going to provide, going to protect us. Since we are reconciled, we have peace with God, our scripture says. Yes, justification results in peace with God. Obviously, if we had to get into heaven by our works, there would be no peace, because there can be no certainty. There's no way we can stand in God's courtroom on the basis of our own works. Work has already been done, since the price has already been paid, since the verdict has already been rendered. Notice it doesn't say you will be justified. Past tense. You are justified. The verdict has already been rendered. God sees you and He says you're not guilty. And that results in peace. Know that we are right with God because of Jesus. We have that confidence and certainty that our sin now no longer separates us from our Creator. We have that confidence and certainty that we're going to dwell in that place of eternal peace. And because we're justified, we live under the grace of God. In our scripture, through Jesus, we also have obtained access by faith into this grace in which we stand. We live each and every day in God's grace. The word grace means favor. God looks at us, He looks at us favorably. We're in His good graces. Again, not because of what He sees in us, but because of Jesus. Yes, we live in and under that grace, in and under the favor of God, because of that free and wonderful gift of God's grace, His undeserved favor and kindness. And because we are justified, because we are declared not guilty, our scripture goes on to say, we have God's love, the gift of the Holy Spirit. Scripture says, God's love has been poured into our hearts through the Holy Spirit, who has been given to us. All because of love. Sang about it earlier. My song is love unknown. My Savior's love to me. In love, Jesus gave His all for us on the cross. And now we have the blessing and the joy of living in that love and abiding in that love. That love of God being poured into our hearts. Scripture says, because we're justified, it's not just the love of God in our hearts, but also the Holy Spirit. God Himself, the Holy Spirit, as He works through word and sacrament, bringing us to faith, keeping us in the faith, guiding us, comforting us, leading us into all truth. Because we're justified, even in suffering, there is blessing. Scripture says that suffering produces endurance, and endurance produces character. And character produces hope. And hope does not disappoint us. And so Paul goes so far to say we even rejoice in our sufferings. We heard in our gospel reading for the week, as followers of Christ, we do have to bear crosses. There are sufferings. There are trials that we have to endure. But when those sufferings and trials come, because we are justified, thought doesn't come into our mind, well, God must hate me. God must be angry with me. God must be pouring forth his wrath upon me. No, as those who are abiding in the love of God, who are coming and returning to the Lord, acknowledging their sins, receiving that free and full forgiveness, yes, there's going to be suffering. That's not suffering coming from a wrathful and vengeful judge, eager to punish us. Instead, when that suffering comes, our loving Father is going to be at work even through that suffering to bless us. Suffering produces endurance. An athlete has to suffer to be a good athlete. Run harder and faster. And so when suffering comes into our lives, it does produce endurance. It does strengthen our faith, make us fortified, strengthening and preserving us in both body and soul to life everlasting. That endurance produces character. What is character? Well, first and foremost, character is identity. Suffering comes, it cements our identity. I belong to Christ. He has me. He holds me. He's going to help me. He's going to keep me. He's going to be there for me. No matter how intense or difficult this trial may be. Of course, through suffering, we do have that Christ-like character that is fostered and nurtured within us. Through suffering, we do become more Christ-like, become more humble as he is humble. Through the sufferings we face, then we are able to be a blessing, to empathize with others when they suffer. Endurance produces character, and character produces hope. That hope that does not put us to shame. Hope. That is a sure and certain hope. Because it's not a hope that is built on our efforts or our works. No, our hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. The text for today begins with those words, therefore, since we have been justified by faith. And then it's like it just explodes with all these blessings and gifts that are ours, because we have been declared not guilty. Yes, we've been saved from the wrath of God. We are reconciled to God. We have peace with God. We live under God's grace. We have the gift of his love, the gift of his Holy Spirit. Yes, God, who even works through suffering, bring about endurance and character and that hope that doesn't disappoint. So as Paul is pondering this gift of justification, this gift of being declared not guilty, he can't help but rejoice. He uses the word rejoice 3 times. He says we rejoice in the hope of the glory of God. He says we rejoice even in our sufferings. And rejoice in God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom we have received reconciliation. Paul's joy is our joy because the verdict is in. You are not guilty. Amen. We sing together hymn 433. Please stand for prayer. Gracious God, our Heavenly Father, we acknowledge that apart from you, we are weak, ungodly, unrighteous, and sinners. We thank you for your great love demonstrated in sending your Son to die for us. We rejoice that we are justified by his blood, and thus we are at peace with you, having been reconciled through your Son. Help us never to trust in ourselves or our own efforts, but to trust solely in your Son, Jesus. Lord, in your mercy. Heavenly Father, preserve and bless all Christian households, that husbands and wives would live in love and service to each other, that fathers and mothers would diligently bring up their children in your fear, and that children would honor their parents and be well equipped for service to their neighbors in this life. We rejoice as Dan and Taffy Schreier celebrate their 47th wedding anniversary, praying that you would bless and strengthen them as they abide in your love. Lord, in your mercy. O Lord, through your Holy Spirit, pour your love into the hearts of all those who suffer in our midst, that their sufferings may produce endurance, endurance character, and character a hope that will not put them to shame. We lift up before your throne of grace Tim Wilkerson, Don Dywert, Barbara Hughes, Stephanie Harris, Nora Cleary, Jim Newton, Dorothy Lynn, John Lagnew, Kathy Hoover, Linda Arnholt, Charlotte Williams, Ben Pence, Francisco Rendon, Elizabeth Scheit, Carl Forster, Rosemary Albright, the residents and staff at Hickory Creek, Doug Brown, Marjorie Podorf, Ashley Pollard, Dee Dee Hinton, Greg Combs, Kayla Cohn, Matt DeWicke, Tim Sarver, Danielle Miller, Deanna Falwell, Riley Bennett, Andy Havener, Emmy Brooks, Tim Isley, Chris Hyatt, Teresa Palmer, Mark Moore, Julie Phillips, Evelyn Rich and Fran Sapper, Connie Ball, and the family and friends of Ken White and Jerry Brown. Lord, in your mercy. Into your hands, O Lord, we commend all for whom we pray, trusting in your mercy through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. We continue with the service of the sacrament on page 208. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is truly good, right, and salutary that we should at all times and in all places give thanks to you, O Lord, Holy Father, almighty and everlasting God, for the countless blessings you so freely bestow on us and all creation. Above all, we give thanks for your boundless love shown to us when you sent your only begotten Son, Jesus Christ, into our flesh and laid on him our sin, giving him into death that we might not die eternally. Because he is now risen from the dead and lives and reigns to all eternity, all who believe in him will overcome sin and death and will rise again to new life. Therefore, with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, we laud and magnify your glorious name, evermore praising you and saying, blessed are you, O Lord, our God, King of all creation, for you have had mercy on us and given your only begotten Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish but have eternal life. In your righteous judgment, you condemned the sin of Adam and Eve, who ate the forbidden fruit, and you justly barred them and all their children from the tree of life. Yet in your great mercy, you promised salvation by a second Adam, your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord, and made his cross a life-giving tree for all who trust in him. We give you thanks for the redemption you have prepared for us through Jesus Christ. Grant us your Holy Spirit, that we may faithfully eat and drink of the fruits of his cross, and receive the blessings of forgiveness, life, and salvation that come to us in his body and blood. Hear us as we pray in his name, and as he has taught us, our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Our Lord Jesus Christ, on the night in which he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to the disciples and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. This do in remembrance of me." In the same way, also after supper, he took the cup. And when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink of it, all of you. This cup is the New Testament in my blood, which is shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. This do as often as you drink it, in remembrance of me." The peace of the Lord be with you always.
Thank you.
Please stand for the blessing. The body and the blood of the Lord strengthen and preserve you in both body and soul to life everlasting. Go in peace. Amen. We sing the Nunc Dimittis, page 211. Let us pray. We give thanks to you, Almighty God, that you have refreshed us through this salutary gift. And we implore you that of your mercy you would strengthen us through the same in faith towards you and in fervent love toward one another. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Let us bless the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace.